Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Kubernetes Bangalore September 2022 meetup. Today, we have a couple of very familiar faces who are joining us after a very long time, right? So I just wanted to touch upon a few things before we get started. And I'll hand it over to you, Suraj, right after. So for those of you who are new, we do this meetup every month. Last month, we did our first in-person meetup after a very long time since pre-COVID times. So in the further couple of months, we'll be mixing it up, right, with virtual meetups, which allows us to get speakers from all over the world, right? And also in-person meetups, which, is generally much more nicer to have, right, with being present in the venue and interacting and networking with people. So we'll be starting off with the first talk in a couple of minutes. Before that, if you have any questions for the speakers, you can post it in the chat section. Or at the end of the talk, you can raise your hand and we'll allow you to unmute yourself and you can ask the question to the speaker directly. Please maintain decency while commenting or providing criticism. Please provide constructive criticism. Right. Also, we are recording this meetup. So in case due to connectivity issues or you drop off, or if you want to share it with someone else, we'll provide you with the recording link after posting it on YouTube and you can share it with everybody else. So without delaying it much further, I'll hand it over to Suraj. Suraj, do you want to introduce Suraj?
Sure. Okay. I don't know what to say. So Suraj Narwade was one of the co-organizers of the meetup previously when he was in India. He works for Uswitch and is currently he's in India, but usually he's in London. So he'll speak to us about service account tokens. I'll let Suraj introduce. He'll do a better job, I think. Over to you, Suraj.
Yeah, thank you. I'll share my screen. Okay, here we go. Thank you, Prakash. So I didn't get much time to prepare, so sorry in advance for my very basic slides. And this is something, so in previous weeks, I was doing upgrades around Kubernetes. And I think Tazdik's talk will shed more light on that. But during the upgrade, especially it was 120 to 121, I noticed few things around service account, which was quite interesting. And I thought I'll share those in my talk. So as Suraj introduced me, I'm senior platform engineer at RVU. So RVU is a UK-based comparison website brand such as uswitch.com and money.co.uk. And what they do is they compare energy, broadband, and mobile and stuff. Along with that, I'm a CNCF ambassador. And recently, I joined this AWS Community Builder program because I mostly nowadays do stuff around EKS. So when we talk about service account, the service account token, now if we look at service account token secret, it does look like this, where you have a CA cert, which is the Kubernetes CA cert, the namespace, which is again, the values are base64 encoded, and there is this token. Now, this token is base64 encoded, but behind the scene, it is a JWT token, right? Which is used for authentication to Kubernetes. Now, let's look inside this token till 120, because as I said, I noticed few interesting issues when I was upgrading my cluster from 120 to 121. So till 120, the token, the JWT token, if you decode it, now, you might get confused with this command. So the view secret is basically a kubectl plugin which shows the base 64 decoded value, and then I piped and gave output to JWT decode command. So when you decode the secret, it does look like this, which has a token header with some algorithm and KID information, and then token claim. Now, if you look at token claim, there was ISS stands for issuer, which says Kubernetes service account. That's a very static value. Then it will show the namespace of that service account, the name of the secret, the service account name, some UID, and the sub is like system service account default test, means the default is the namespace and the test, right? Very simple token format, and with the help of this, the authentication happens, and then your application can interact with the API server. Like, I'm not going to go into the depth because I just want to showcase the what's the difference and what we can do with it. Now, what does that mean? Like, these tokens are the static tokens, right? Like, whether you are using them from inside the pod by your application, or you are using the token from the secret which was generated by the service account, right? With, like, you can literally do kubectl get pod and --, token. These are static tokens, non-expiring. That means not very secure, right? But from 121 onwards, Kubernetes introduced this new service account token format where if we again decode this token and take a look, the token header now is pretty much same, but if you look at token claim, there are a couple of new things, such as audience, which is the name of the Kubernetes API server service, which is kubernetes.default.cluster.local. EXP is expiry, meaning expiry of this token. IAT is like issued at, when this token was issued. Again, issuer, who issued the token. So in this case, the Kubernetes API server issued this particular token, and couple of more information, right? Now, these numbers, which are either expiry or issued at or NBF is not before, these numbers are, I think they are Unix number. Like if you convert Unix timestamp to normal number, you will be able to see the actual date and time format, right? Now, what does this new service account format means? This means these tokens are hard to steal and misuse, because one of the reason is these tokens are not generated as part of secret with service account, but they are mounted as a projected volume inside your pod. So if someone has to really steal this secret, they have to go inside the pod and get that token. They are not available outside. The second thing is they are time bound and audience bound and object bound. Time bound, as in, as we have seen, it does have expiry. So for example, a life of this token will be 2 hours, and after 2 hours, this token will be not valid. And audience bound and object bound correlates with the more standardized format, which is OIDC format. Now, this particular token format is very compliant with the OIDC format, which now OIDC is a very standard for authentication and not really related to Kubernetes. But now with the help of now that the service account is in the OIDC format, you can now integrate Kubernetes and application with various other OIDC compliant systems as well, right? And as I said, these tokens are distributed to pod with the help of this projected volume type. Now, because there is now this projected volume type, you can mount this token to any path that you want, along with the default path, which is var run secret service account token. Now, if you compare these two types of token side by side, you will see the ISS has now become, instead of the static value Kubernetes service account, it has become the issuer URL. Now, when I was taking these snippets, I did it on Minikube. That's why you will see Kubernetes.default. But if you are using EKS or AKS or any managed Kubernetes service, you will see the OIDC issuer URL given by those managed Kubernetes services and the expiry and issued at basically the time bound. Now, this is a massive difference and massive change in the form of how service accounts are being implemented. Now, there will be some changes we will have to take if we want to go from 120 to 121. Now, I'm pretty sure many of you already have Kubernetes on much, much latest versions, right? But if you have from 120 to 121, this is useful for you, right? Now, what we have to do is the very basic thing is, if you have any application which interacts with a Kubernetes API server, such as if you have any your custom controller written or something like cert manager, we need to make sure their client libraries, means client Go or any Python Kubernetes client or Java client, they need to be on the specific version. And reason for that is the client libraries before this versions were designed to read these static service account tokens. And after these versions, I think community implemented a new solution where the client can actually renew the token based on the expiry and all this stuff. So in order to make sure that our app is running perfectly fine without any issue, we will need to update these client libraries. The second important thing which I observed was Vault. Like, even the mechanism of, like, even in case of Vault, it uses service account to authenticate with Kubernetes cluster and like delivering the credentials, like database credential or any other. Because of these new token format, the process with which Vault talks to the Kubernetes has also been changed. It's very well documented in the Vault documentation, but that is something we'll need to change as well, right? Now, the question arises is these all things, this which I mentioned on the slide, helps for the application which are running on the kube itself, right? But there may be some things which are running outside the Kubernetes, but they are interacting to Kubernetes. For example, CI, like let's say Drone CI or Jenkins CI, they are interacting with Kubernetes with the help of service account static token. So till now, like in my case at least, we were using static tokens. Now, option for that is either you create a secret, which I showed on the screen like this, and in annotation, you mentioned the service account name, and you create yet another static token, which won't have the expiry or anything, and then use that token into the CI. But again, it is still risky, and I won't recommend because it's still a static token. It doesn't have expiry, and if someone exploits this token, can have access to your Kubernetes cluster. Now, option to this is use some different sort of mechanism. For example, if you are in a AWS world, maybe you give some sort of IAM permissions and implement IAM-based auth, which will remove the dependency of having a service account token. So I think that was my whatever I learned last week with a service account when I was migrating. Any questions? I'll stop sharing.
I If you want to speak up, please raise your hands. We'll unmute you.
You can also post your questions on the chat.
Yeah, Joyous raised his hand. Can you mute?
Hey, hi, Suraj.
Hello.
So yeah, I joined on the late side of the talk, but since you finished it with AWS, like, did you like talk about OIDC and IRSA and how those two things sort of go hand in hand for service accounts?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
OIDC, auth, and IRSA, IRSA, IAM role for service accounts.
I think this was not related to IRSA. It was more of a interacting to cluster from outside and not from the application itself.
But we can leverage OIDC auth for connecting other identities from outside the cluster too, right?
Yes, right. We definitely can. But I think what, like, I'll share my experience, like why I decided to come up with this. Because when we were decide to do 120 to 121 upgrade, right? The biggest question was like, what's really happening? What's really changing? And then the CI has this static tokens, what to do with it? So yeah, I think the applications which are running inside the Kubernetes, we did like IRSA and all that stuff, but one which are outside of the cluster, there are multiple ways to solve it. Either you create new OIDC identity and then use IRSA even for the stuff which is running outside the cluster, or other ways like you add entries to that AWS auth config map, and then, you know, that way you give permission to the entity.
One thing I found always is the AWS auth IAM config, like, it's one of the most unreliable pieces of engineering. You never know how the mapping actually works. System master suddenly gives you everything, so it's a little bit precarious there. Cool. Thanks for answering the question.
Yeah. Cool. Thank you. Any more question? If not, thank you so much. Yeah, and feel free to connect to me if you have any more questions.
Yeah, any questions from the chat? Can you hear me, Suraj?
Yeah, you're audible, yes.
Okay, so if there are no questions, I think we can move ahead with the second talk, right? Okay, so thanks a lot, Suraj, for an awesome talk on service account and tokens. So without further ado, let me introduce our second speaker, Mehant, who works as a research software engineer at IBM in their research lab, Bangalore. He's also a contributor to Convoyer and Move2Q projects in CNCF landscape. Very much passionate about cloud native technologies. So take it over, Mehant.
Thanks, Humble, for the introduction. One Okay. So is my screen visible?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. Thanks a lot. So as Humble mentioned, I'm Mihant and I work at IBM Research as a software engineer. And I am passionate about cloud native technologies. I'm relatively early in my career, so I started up learning things. This talk is going to be, I know this is weekend, but talk is going to be in two parts. The first one is I'm gonna talk briefly about different projects in Conveyor and Mooticube in depth. And then we'll have a demo to show how Mooticube actually works. So Conveyor is an open source community. So it's a group of people who are passionate about helping others and organizations to help in their replatforming and migration journey of their legacy applications. So this is done with the help of some of the tools which we have in the suite, and also some best practices integrated into it, which are done by continuous discussions and evaluations. So recently Conveyor has been identified as a CNCF sandbox project, and that's where it's going to take another direction in the same region, but in much more growth to give much more ability and to further the mission of helping organizations in this particular problem. So you can learn more about Conveyor Mooticube, Conveyor at conveyor.io. So that's. So as I said, Conveyor is a suite of projects. So right now, I'm going to just brief about each project, but please feel free to look at conveyor.io, and there's a lot of documentation for each project, and you might be interested in one of them, and you probably can use it in your own way. So for now, the hub basically is like interface to keep all these projects at one place and help user to use them, and probably can use them along or connect them along to help in the replatform journey. So another project is Mooticube. So I'll be talking in depth of this about this project in the rest of the slides. So it is used to accelerate this particular replatforming problem or replatforming journey for legacy applications to Kubernetes. And there's another project called Pelorus. Pelorus is used to measure software delivery performance. And the other project is Tackle. So Tackle has a set of projects within it, like a test generator, which is used to automatically generate tests for your code, and containerization advisor, which uses NLP to advise container images for based on the application description that you give, and Diva to help in at the data layer of your application, help there in during your replatforming journey. And there are two other assessing tools, Pathfinder and Windup, for your source code and application. So there's another project called Data Gravity Insights, to provide insights while let's say you're refactoring your monolith to microservices. So I know this is a bit very briefly explained, but please feel free to visit conveyor.io, and I think that would be much helpful because of the time frame and also the preparation that I had. I think I would be moving on to the next slide. So as I told, I'll be talking about Mooticube. So Mooticube is a tool, and also it's an automated human in the loop tool, and also it has a powerful transformer framework, which makes it extensible. So this particular tool is used to accelerate your replatforming journey or replatforming of your application to Kubernetes. So in this slide, we'll be talking about different capabilities that Mooticube has, and how it does this how it tackles this replatforming problem. So let's say you have an application, it could be taking up any form. Probably it's written Python, or it could be a Cloud Foundry application, or application deployed on Docker Swarm, or it could be some custom application which is yet to be identified. So whatever, we have this discovery capability of Mooticube, where we try to discover what kind of application what set of applications that in a particular enterprise app is comprised of. And then once the discovery is done, we connect this particular information to the next step, that is containerization, where we try to build or produce container artifacts like build packs and Docker files in order to containerize them. And the next part is the other two steps, the transformation and the parameterization step. So in transformation and parameterization, we're trying to build the target platform artifacts. Probably there could be Kubernetes YAMLs, or it could be some CI/CD pipeline YAMLs, and et cetera, and other custom artifacts based on the needs. And finally, we have something called customization. As I told before, MutaCube is an automated human in the loop tool. So basically, it's automated, but we'll be having an architect or an expert in replatforming, or probably not an expert, but probably a person who is concerned about the target artifacts that he wants to consume. So probably it can be us who is using the tool. So let's say that he is working in an organization and he wants to have those target artifacts comply with his organization. So in that case, MutaCube provides this customization facility or capability where he can add customizations on top of MutaCube and then get the transformations done based on his need. So this is a high level overview of different capabilities that MutaCube has and how it tackles the replatforming problem. Where does MutaCube actually fit in an enterprise replatforming journey, or how it actually fits? So let's say an enterprise has hundreds of applications, and it is made up of, like, let's say it is written in different languages, probably 10 applications written in Python, or 10 other in Java, or maybe there could be Spring Boot applications, and then 10 other could be in other forms. So whatever, so the way we tackle this is we try to bring up a small set of applications. We call it representative apps. Let's say one app from Python, one app from the Go, and let's say one other app from the other technology that has been used. And once we have the small set of applications, we give it as an input to MutaCube, and MutaCube seamlessly does the transformation with the help of its inbuilt transformers and its core code. And once that is done, we would be getting the target artifacts. Target artifacts, as I told before, it could be Kubernetes YAMLs, CI/CD pipelines, etc. Once that is done, the human or the architect who is interested in those target artifacts, he could actually look at them, and probably he might be thinking, hey, I want some customizations, as I told before. And then he could also, so in that case, he could actually add customizations on top of MutaCube and get obviously the artifacts that comply with his needs. So this is where it fits in. MutaCube has two interfaces, a CLI and a web interface. It could help in different cases. Let's say CLI, if you're interested with that, or let's say you're in an organization and you wanted to have a single interface, a web interface that people can access and work on these transformations. So both are provided and both are open source, and you could find them on Conveyor GitHub repository, one with MutaCube and one other with MutaCube -UI. All right, so let's talk about the CLI interface, and let me tell you how easy it is to use MutaCube tool. One way to use it is with the transform subcommand. So basically, it's as simple as MutaCube transform source folder as an input with S as an option or flag. So source folder is basically the source code of the enterprise app. It could have different technologies it is written in, or different microservices or components within it. And that's it. And MutaCube, with the help of its built-in transformers and the core code, it tries to analyze the artifacts and then produce the target artifacts. That's how the MutaCube works. And the other option to use is a complex way of using it, or maybe an involved way to do this is a two-step process. The first step, we try to create a plan file. A plan file is basically, it tries to list different services or applications that were discovered by the transformers. Okay, I'm using this transformers word a lot. I'm going to talk about transformers in the next slide. So right now, bear with me with that. So it will list different services or applications detected, and different other metadata related to that. And also it would list what all transformers would be involved in the transformation journey. And this particular single file would be helpful for the architect or the person who is in the loop to understand what the MutaCube is going to do in the rest of the transformation journey. And the next step is the transform file, where we give the plan file as an input, and that's it. So MutaCube does the transformation based on the plan and creates the target artifacts. There's an optional step which we call it as MotorCube collect. So using the collect subcommand, basically you can grab information from runtime environments. Let's say you have a Cloud Foundry environment on your system where your MotorCube transformation is happening. Probably you can use this collect subcommand to grab that runtime information. Let's say what applications are running on a Cloud Foundry, and this could aid in the transformation process. Well, I've been using this transformer word a lot in the previous slides. So transformer makes MotorCube extensible and really powerful framework. Because if you know how it works, that would be pretty much understandable. So all these boxes that you see is a transformer. So transformer tries to do a bit of task or small bit size task of transformation, where it tries to make use of two things. We call it artifacts and path mappings. So a transformer takes an artifact as an input, which helps it to understand. It helps in, let's say, like a communication between two transformers. So it takes artifacts as an input. It does its transformation on the artifacts or the source artifacts, basically, and then it gives out two things as an output: other set of artifacts and second thing is path mappings. So path mappings is like a side effect of a transformation. Let's say some files that have been created by the transformer, let's say some configuration file that has been created during the process, or let's say a Docker file created during the transformation process. And the other artifacts is like as I told you, it's like a message for communication. So other transform, it would help to understand what are the next set of transformers that have to be invoked based on the artifact type that is being released by the previously done transformer. So they go hand in hand process right from the source artifacts and until they build the target platform artifacts that are required. And right here, the other point to tell is I told MotorCube is extensible. That basically means that in the next slide, I'm going to talk more about it. But the point is you can write your own custom transformers that can be well integrated into MotorCube, and that could help in a seamless transformation journey to happen. So you could customize these transformers, as I told before. The first thing is, as I told you, there are inbuilt transformers which are written in Go in the MotorCube code. You could customize on top of it. It gives a way to do that. And the second thing is you could write your own transformers, and it's made very easy for you because you can write it in Python, probably if you think so. Not Python, but Starlark, which is Python-like programming language. And so basically you make use of the SDK that the MotorCube provides, the functions and the variables that MotorCube provides, and you can do your transformation or analysis that you would like to do. And you can write it as a custom transformer, and then you can integrate it to MotorCube very easily. And the other way is to use transformers in a container. Basically you have a transformer written in a container, and then you can integrate it back to MotorCube. All right. So there are many use cases on how MotorCube handles. You could look at them at motorcube.conveyor.io/tutorials. So basically, the different cases have been discussed on how it handles Cloud Foundry to Kubernetes and different transformations. As you can go and have a look at it and how MotorCube handles that. All right, so MotorCube is not a tool which has been done on some, small projects, but it has been well tested on different real-time case studies. So a few of them have been mentioned here. These are some quantitative results that could support how powerful MotorCube can be. So for example, let's say one of the case studies is an INSAP, which is written in Spring Boot, and the front end is written in Angular, and it has been deployed on a Docker Swarm. So we would like to replatform this application to Kubernetes. So it is a big application with hundreds of services or modules written in. And within rough estimate, it could take around 56 days because to transform. And if you could do that with MotorCube, it would take a much lower time, as you see here. And Yeah, so this is how Mutikub reduces the time. And other aspect of this results could be, you could say a qualitative result where, in the manual effort, probably you need the persons who are in the transformation should have the knowledge or the expertise in the transformation. So in Mutikub, most of it has been waived. All right, so this is my last slide. So, well, so as I told, Convoy is an open source community and Mutikub is growing and it's an open source project as well. So please feel free to try it out. So maybe you could contribute with the help of PRs and raise issues. And yes, we are part of Hacktoberfest. It's a way we could encourage contributors to contribute to our code. And you could find all the repos which Mutikub has, the UI, CLI at this particular URL. And also Mutikub repos at convoy/Mutikub on GitHub. And please feel free to give a GitHub star because this could help Mutikub to reach out to different audiences, your followers to make use of it. Yeah, and we also have a Slack channel where in the Kubernetes organization where you could, with the channel with Convoy as a name, you could actually bring up any questions you have on the way. So that is it. How much time I'm left with?
No, you have, I mean, we have time. We have a couple of questions on the chat.
Sure. I mean, I have a demo to show.
Okay. So maybe let's hold those questions till we are done with the demo. Yep. Sure.
All right. So, I hope my screen is visible.
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay. Sure. So, so I'm going to show one of the quick demos where Mutikub replatforms a Cloud Foundry app to Kubernetes. So this is app which is deployed on IBM Bluemix using Cloud Foundry. So this is just the end result of the app which could just look like. And now I'm going to transform this with the help of Mutikub and then deploy it on Kubernetes. I'm going to show that in a file. All right, so okay. Is there a way I could that's just blocking my CLI, so at the moment, so, yeah. All right, so I'll tell you, so the source code for this particular app that you've seen before is in this folder. So it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So basically it has 6 services that I mentioned in the, so basically services is just different modules working together, front end and different services in the back end. And it also has a database service. So yeah, so database service has already got the Kubernetes YAMLs, and we assume that it's an external database which is not part of the transformation. For now, this source folder, as you can see, it has a Java code and that's it. It has no Docker files or any other containerization or deployment artifacts. So yeah. So the first thing is, you know where the source code is, and either we can use CLI, Mutikub CLI to do this. So, Mutikub has a very powerful QA engine. So with QA engine, basically, whenever there's an ambiguity during the transformation, Mutikub transformers can raise questions to the person who is part of the transformation, and he could actually clarify or give answers to it. Probably the something that is not missing from the source code. Let's say some externalized variables or externalized information. So yeah, that is it. So when I transform this application, there could be many questions. So I have actually put some of the answers to these questions in this config file. So Mutikub has this something called YAML config file where we can give this answers to the different questions as a YAML so that you could skip over the QA part. And additionally, it also provides a flag QA skip, in order to skip the QA engine questions, and it goes by with the defaults. So I have left few of the questions here so that you could actually understand how QA engine actually works along with the transformation. So I'll use motor cube, transform, and I give path to source, and dash f is to give the config which has the answers to questions. All right. So Mooticube, so basically, as I told, one of the steps, discover capabilities where it has detected 5, which is implemented as part of the transfer, each transformer, which is responsible for it. And it does the remaining part of the transformation. As you can see, there's a question that it raised. It says, there's this containerization step. I'm stopped it. And I have detected that you have a Maven file. So probably that means that your services needs a Maven based container image. And I say yes, and it goes on, it takes the Maven Dockerfile, it tries to parameterize it and then fix it, make it available. And then it asks what kind of, the registry that I'm using. So probably right now we have to, so we just say that. And then it asks for the registry namespace. So I'm gonna use mine on Docker, so. So let's say the registry is private, so probably you can give username the password and mine is public, so I'm going with no authentication. Yeah, so you might be thinking, these are the steps, probably you might incur, come across a couple of questions, but I am a little bit automating it with the config file that I showed before. And then I'm gonna give local because localhost. So I'm gonna use that because I'm using Minikube right now, so I don't have an comment to show. All right, so. So Minikube does the transformations and it shows, it produced these artifacts or let's say files. So, it has a source, basically source as the source folder, which is the source code that we have given as an input. So for each service, it created the Docker file based on the based on the technology that is being written in. And that is done for the other services as well, as you can see. So this is the source. And then we Mooticube also produces some helpful scripts to build the Docker images, as you can see, and also to push those images based on the input that you have given in the, the QA engine. So I'm skipping this build and push step right now because it could take a longer time. So I've already done that work. So kept it in my Docker Hub. So I'll just grab it from there. And the other artifacts that I have told are the target platform artifacts. So Mooticube out of the box produces these artifacts, the YAML files, which are the Kubernetes YAML files and the Helm charts or other parameterization supported technologies like customize. And then we have the native configurations and Docker Compose file, which probably you can use if you want to test it out locally. And so CI/CD pipelines also produced by the Mooticube. So, this is how Mooticube produce the target platform artifacts, and we could use that to simply apply to our Kubernetes cluster and get it done. So, all right. So, Mooticube also gives an option to mention your target Kubernetes cluster. It just not supports Kubernetes, but it could support other proprietary like Google, AWS, IBM, etc. So that's it. So I just want to see if my queue. My cluster is up already. So, all right. So I'm applying the Kubernetes YAMLs now. So this is a step. Okay. And I'm applying the database files, which I shown before. Yeah, so now you have the database pods. Yeah, so just turning up, not taking too much time. So. You should be ready. Okay, so I need to redo the English, but let's see. Well, so I just gave one second. I just fix that. Yes. Yep. Fix that. Sorry for the delay. We just had some hiccups here. Let me clear that up. Should be good. So let's see if things are running. Okay. All right. So we have everything deployed. Let's see. Good. After that. Okay. So yeah, I have to do a meetup run so that I could forward the okay. So yeah. The application is deployed now. Probably you can see it's a little bit buggy right now. The reason is we are using Postgres, and Postgres has I think it. It has to spin up, and it's gonna take a bit of time. I'll just show you. So we have an init script which creates. This is not produced by Mutakube, but we consider that this is external to Mutakube. But we have to create some tables, and this init script actually does it when it starts up. But it's gonna take a bit of time for the Postgres to spin up. So yeah, it's ready. So you can see the tables fetched from the, yeah. So that is it. We can see that it's deployed and it resembles the app on Cloud Foundry. Yeah. Yeah, that's the, yeah, I think I might have missed a few things, but yeah, that's the demo. Thank you. All right.
We have any more questions?
Yeah, I see a couple of questions over the chat, but Ashok has answered, I believe.
Yeah, so we have Ashok, Akash, and others from our team. So they joined the communities.
Okay. So any more questions?
Folks, if you have any question, you can raise your hand and we'll unmute you as well if you don't feel like typing it on the chat. And thanks, Akash and Ashok, for answering the questions.
Yeah, so one more fact is Ashok is actually the creator of Conway Mutakube, and Akash has been working for about, for long contributing to the project. Yeah, that's another point.
Awesome. I don't see any questions or any raised hands. So I would like to thank you, ma'am, for spending this time with us on a Friday evening.
Sure. I would love to,
That was a great talk. And we will definitely be sharing the slides with the audience after the talk. Right. So without further ado, let's get to the final talk of the evening. So Tastik is joining us from Germany. So he has, while he was in Bangalore, while he was in India, he was a very active participant in the meetups. And so he, today he's joining us from Germany. He works as a senior systems engineer at Delivery Hero in Germany. So he'll be talking to us about cluster upgrades and trying to keep up with them. Over to you, Tastik.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yes.
Awesome. Thanks for the lovely introduction and glad to be back, folks. This talk is just gonna be my experiences so far, as, and I'm sure you folks will also have experiences, so about this thing called cluster upgrades, right? So without much ado, let's just get started, right? So I should have rather renamed this to trying to keep up with cluster upgrades, right? Why should we upgrade anyway, right? Just to have a bit of context, if someone is new to Kubernetes here, but just to have the context here for everybody, there are a couple of things which end up happening, which could be one of the reasons why you end up upgrading the Kubernetes versions which you are running, right? It could be API deprecations. It could be that there are just more stable APIs which have been released in your versions, which just serve you better. Multiple security patches for CVEs. Version deprecations is something which also ends up happening for the kind of objects which you have been using for your workloads, which get deprecated over the versions. And of course, incremental changes are always better than big bang changes. Bottom line, upgrade frequently to prevent infrastructure rot, right? Now, if you have not done cluster upgrades before, you might be wondering, is this really specific to Kubernetes, right? Wherever you run your compute, this process of upgrading is not really new. Compute layer has always had this problem statement inside teams where you have to have upgrades at some point about something, right? Now, how you do it would end up in this layer would be different in terms of what kind of operating system you are running, what language stacks you're running, and which applications are running inside these compute instances. So imagine you have a fleet of X number of servers and you need to have some inventory in case. So for you, in order to track which servers to upgrade for specific CVEs or operating system deprecations, right? How you handle them is again another problem statement, which I'm sure you folks must have encountered at some point. How you manage them? Some people end up rolling out immutable infrastructure via golden AMIs. You do blue-green replacements. And worst case, but it still works, you upgrade in place via Ansible or tools like Chef and Puppet, right? Which is also another way in which you manage infrastructure, right? Before we move forward, let's quickly also take a quick peek about what has been the historical release base for some of these managed Kubernetes providers so far, right? What we end up seeing, the source of this screenshot is this website, which a friend of mine has built, and it just tracks the releases of EKS over the years and months. So if we have a look at the bottom, the 1.18 release got released a year and 11 months. And the next version was just a couple of months after this. And you can see a trend here. And if you notice, the end of support is also just barely keeping up around the same release cadence, right? Now, if we look at other providers, for instance, GKE, the release cadence and maintenance window is somewhat similar. It's barely a couple of months in most cases, right? the release cadence for other cloud providers and managed solutions would most likely follow a similar cadence, but I have just given you examples of the two most, or rather, if I may reframe, the two cloud providers which I have ended up using over time. Now, what could be the reason for such a release velocity in the first place, right? What I ended up noticing was that Upstream has roughly 4 releases every year, which means a new version is out every 3 months, right? So the version 1.22, for example, and then there would be another version just out of the window in another few months, the 1.24 is released, right? There has been a discussion around SIG release, specifically in terms of the enhancement proposal 2572, where there was a discussion of increasing this duration and releasing 3 releases of the Upstream cadence rather than 4 releases. Some key points which are specific to the end users and the distributors of these downstream projects would be that they try capturing the pain which ends up happening with the 4 releases. The obvious one is that you have to keep up with them, right? And of course, you would find me in one of these threads commenting, let's decrease the release cadence. But let's also look at what ends up happening when you don't upgrade, right? Because worst case in operating systems for just bare minimum virtual machines, what ends up happening is something which you would not probably see in these managed distributions. These managed providers have certain standards, and one of them is to force upgrade your control plane, depending on how old or how old of a version it is running. And they will upgrade your control plane if you don't do it yourself. And the worst possible outcome, which you can imagine for your production workloads, is an outage, which you would obviously want to avoid if you're part of the infrastructure team. Security incidents are a dime a dozen if you don't really upgrade for a very long time. Even if there was a way in which the managed provider doesn't upgrade your clusters, there will be security incidents. Since we have touched upon a couple of topics of why is there such a high release cadence process, such a high number of releases every year, and what do these providers do, let's quickly also take a look at how can we optimize for such a high velocity cadence upgrades release cadence, and how can we keep up with them. A very bare minimum which I have ended up noticing as something which I feel is required is to just manage your state for your cluster with some automation, or something which is used by a larger community which you can find help around with. It could be Terraform, it could be CloudFormation. Find the tool which works for you. Self-hosting your Kubernetes cluster. Of course not. Avoid unless you have a very special case, because if you are not in the business of providing Kubernetes as a solution or as a distribution to other people, this is a rabbit hole which you don't want to go to. Because now you would have 2 problems. One would be to keep up with the cadence release cadences. And the second is to manage this beast which you have in question. Again, another bare minimum is to have a staging setup. Rather, if I may rephrase, having staging as close to prod. But we try, right? Again, a succession to the last slide. Have your staging run X version for Y time before upgrading your production to the next version. Again, a no-brainer, but is a basic hygiene which you should follow, because time and again, production does throw up instances where you have outcomes or exceptions which you would have never caught. Another aspect of this is you probably could also have a load test environment for your applications where you throw in the kind of traffic which you may never see, but which would allow you to see how your cluster behaves, right? This is something which I would really highly recommend, and I'm sure you probably would be using this already, is to offload your compute to managed nodes. This could be given in EKS in terms of managed node groups, or in GKE, it would be named something similar. Point being, move to this if you can and if your workload allows you to. Have smaller clusters as a trade-off. The reason for this is of why have smaller clusters, because it just allows you to reduce the blast radius. At the same time, it allows you to reduce the amount of time which you spend in upgrading clusters. As if you might have upgraded any of a large cluster, and large would be a subjective statement here, but for me, just for the discussion of this talk, it could be probably 50 nodes in the cluster, and you might see an upgrade time frame of close to an hour if you are doing an upgrade. Again, this is just as an example. I mention it as a trade-off because, as again, sizing or having Kubernetes clusters and how many should you have is again an organizational problem, which is in itself another discussion of a talk, which I'll not delve into right now. A couple of cloud providers let you have add-ons for certain components like AWS Node. There are other components which are required for the functionality of your Kubernetes cluster, like kubeproxy. Offload them to the cloud provider. This is not something which you want to manage. I mean, you have to manage, but if someone else is managing this for you, just let them. The next obvious thing is, since the upgrade process would be something extremely subjective to your organization and how you have set up Kubernetes, try removing each and every human bottleneck eventually. Touching the topic of automation, you must have noticed that there would be a bunch of things which you end up doing while upgrading a cluster or the number of clusters which you have. The next gradual step is to obviously reduce the time, and one way to achieve it is via automation. What you see here is a GitHub issue on the container roadmap for AWS. If you would have used GKE, you might have noticed that there are a couple of ways in which you can quite literally automate or let GKE handle most of these upgrade processes for your cluster. But this is something which is still an open issue for EKS, where if you do run EKS clusters, you still have to make do with the process of triggering this upgrade process for your managed nodes, as well as the components, the add-ons actually, and the cluster control plane. But I'm sure they'll figure this out. What happens with automation is that it helps you upgrade clusters after it reaches a certain number in your organization. It reduces the toil, quite obviously, reducing in terms of offloading this repetition. I may rephrase the last slide as that it is necessary to scale upgrades once cluster numbers increase. The reason why I say this is because if automation is always a moving target, and given the number of clusters which you might have and the release cadence which we have right now from the upstream and the managed cloud providers, you would most definitely see someone from your team doing upgrades or someone cycling through these upgrade processes more than once in a month if you do upgrade quite frequently. You could do pre-upgrade checks as part of your automation checks. This could be as simple as seeing if you have the pods running fine? What are the API deprecations for the next version of Katus, which you are going to upgrade to? And what pods are not running? And let your application teams know about it. Although the last case is highly unlikely in the case of production, but you managing the infrastructure and you upgrading or introducing a change, if I may phrase it that way, the application team should not have surprises at the end of the day. This is an opinionated take. Avoid shell scripts if you can. Make use of the cloud provider APIs which they gave out, or the Katus clients written in the numerous programming languages, which is most comfortable to your team. The idea is to have something maintainable as well as something which is testable. What next? After you upgrade the cluster, you could have something similar to what you did for pre-upgrade checks to just see what is happening inside your cluster. Did the upgrade happen or not? Are the things running fine? Is there something which is not running? A lot of times, especially in EKS, these node maintenance operations, especially for the node groups which are self-managed, you have to do the taint and drain operations to move the workloads around. You could probably just do it manually, but you could clearly see that this will take a huge amount of time if you start doing this manually over and over for multiple clusters. Again, automation will assist you, but rather, if I may phrase, it will help you bridge the gap between having a slow process to rather a more faster process, right? There is a lot of existing automation out there. Make sure you look around and use it to your specific use case. Worst case, if you don't find something fitting your use case, go ahead and write your automation, because automation at the end of the day, if abstracted the right way, is a force multiplier. So do your team a favor and do add the automation which you want to see. A couple of things which you might notice as a difference between GKE and EKS in this case would be that there is something called as a release channel in GKE, which if you attach your cluster to, GKE would quite literally take care of upgrading your node pools as well as the control plane. Whereas in EKS, you don't have something like that as of now. In GKE, there is also this channel where you can just attach the GKE cluster to a static version. In this case, you would have to upgrade the cluster by yourself. There is another component in this, which is called the autopilot mode, where the cluster operations, again, are highly abstracted. I have not personally used it, but if you can, evaluate it. Again, for EKS cluster add-ons, go ahead and make use of them if you can. One not talked about aspect so far is documentation. Document everything, because if not, if you have been doing the cluster upgrades for quite some time, things do change and they will change. For every new person doing the upgrades, you would have to go ahead and explain them each and everything. Document everything. Write it down in a doc. It could be anything. A GitHub page, a small doc out there in your internal documentation page, or a video showing a couple of operations which you are doing. Point being, document it. Again, as part of documentation, just have a map of your compatibility matrix of the components with the specific versions. Not only will this allow you to have the versions mapped to certain things for your clusters, but it would also allow you not being the bottleneck of information. If not anything, add this to your automation. No better way. As a closing thought, upgrades shouldn't be an afterthought. You should be on top of them and plan them ahead. a couple of links for you to read ahead. And a bunch of these are just discussions and docs, which you would probably notice. There is one specific GitHub link, which you will see that there is a tool which we ended up writing for a couple of these operations, which we ended up seeing for our specific use case. Feel free to have a look. It's not perfect, but at the same time, it did get a couple of things done for us. And thank you so much. That's pretty much. Feel free to ask any questions you have.
There is one question in the chat though.
Hi.
Just to speak it out loud, the question is just wondering if the upgrades always have a cost associated with them. It's true, the upgrades will have cost associated with it. If you have something running, if it could be some feature which you have added to your code base, or it could be infrastructure, right? I don't see a dissimilarity between these two things. And as with everything running, your production workloads, to have it run in a better way, there is gonna be maintenance in the terms of code deletion, or in the case of infrastructure where you upgrade it or you replace it with something. So there is always a cost associated with such operations. There's another comment which says, when we have self-managed KDS ecosystem, switching over to DR environment will be an ideal approach. I think it's more of a comment, Vijay, if I'm not wrong. Or so you're saying, could you rephrase it? I'm sorry, or maybe I'm getting it wrong.
Vijay, if you want to speak up, I can unmute you.
Am I audible?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I was asking whether switching over to DR environment would be an ideal approach. Just a opinion I'm asking, because in a highly critical production environment, sometimes the business owners may be asking to switch over to DR environment. In that scenario, what would be our ideal take? That was my question. In case if we run
say running DR as self-managed?
Yeah, DR also self-managed. Maybe and production, maybe hybrid, something like a self as well as hosting providers. But for critical workloads, if they want to have one dedicated DR environment, so that during that upgrade window, something. The IOPS or whatever they want to divert it to DR as a passive mode. Is there any scenario did we come across in any of the production environment? Just I'm asking.
That's a good question. To just answer it before we discuss this further, I want to just point out that having your DR as self-managed and having your production as a hybrid is something which I would not recommend, simply because now you have your production with a different setup on both sides, the DR and the one which is serving traffic, right? But again, like if you're doing the setup a certain way, it could be either self-managed for your own reasons, or it could be running on a managed cloud provider. Just go ahead with the same setup. You could have your specific DR requirements, but I don't feel the need to have, or at least given the constraints which you have put forward a need to have a self-managed DR. It might be cheaper, but at the same time, you have to also look at it from the perspective of maintenance, which is, I think, the bigger question here at the end of the day. DR at the cost of what? And what if this DR is not maintained properly at the end of the day because the team doesn't have that much of effort being put into it simply because of other firefighting or other feature engineering, right? So I think that first problem to tackle is to have the problem being solved for both the DR and the production which you are serving the traffic from to be as close as possible, and something which is repeatable, I guess. I'm not sure if I answered your question though.
Yes, it makes sense. Fantastic. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm.
There's a question by Rohit for hybrid cluster before upgrading it. Do you have any recommendations for Valero backup using Restic? I'm currently exploring the best way to do that, but could not validate my idea. That's something which I missed covering on my slides. That's something, Rohit, which you should absolutely do. Taking backups via, I mean, if we go back to the bare minimum basics, like if you are self-hosting it, the backup is pretty much a backup of your etcd, right? But I would highly recommend taking backups and actually testing that backup, because this is something which happens so often that you have a backup, but when it hits the fan, you really don't see the backup working, right? So, but I mean, it's quite also reasonably valid to just upgrade your staging, let it run for some time, let your application developers evaluate things, and then upgrade your production, right? And since we are chunking the upgrade process by a couple of steps, it's pretty reasonable to catch something early on, say in staging. But as another hygiene check, backups are certainly recommended. Does that answer your question, Ruth? Or... Thanks. Moving to the next question. I doubt getting the issues are the favorite of the PV. I mean, which driver? I think that was the last question. Or does anybody else questions? There's a question which asks about sharing experiences around downtimes during EKS upgrades. Are there any edge cases or scenarios that are easy to miss which might cause a problem during upgrades? I mean, it's not an edge case because most of these things would be heavily documented. You would be hard find to find a case in, say, an offering on these cloud providers where you would notice an edge case and it was glaringly missing in their documentation or not faced by anybody in the community. So removing that edge case aspect of it, I think, to just share some experiences, we have had instances where we were hosting a self-managed Kubernetes cluster long back for an organization, and 2-3 hours into production, we had an outage. And the problem was with etcd also being hosted as a pod inside the self-hosted cluster. And the outage was pretty long, let me just put it that way. And we had to spin up the virtual machines to have as a backup and point out traffic in that side. That was one outage which I can remember as one of the first outages that I saw. Again, like, I think most problems have arisen with the fact that we have tried, or I have seen teams where we have hosted Kubernetes simply because the managed, we were on a cloud provider when EK, when they were not giving out Kubernetes as a distribution, and we wanted to start moving to container workloads, and there was we found Kubernetes to be the right solution at that point, right? So self-hosting was the only alternative at that moment for containerization, for us at least. And more problems arising from that was that a couple of bugs around CNIs where the IPAM would simply not function and the IPs would not get assigned to pods. Such situations would arise. Now imagine trying to firefight such problems where you have to delve into the CNI's code base itself to just see what is really happening, right? Which I would highly recommend people to do wherever they can, just go as deep as you can. Again, outages where the kubelet would simply stop responding due to the load on the node, and the pods are still getting scheduled onto it due to some bug, right? At least that's what I remember once of one of the outcomes of the kubelet not responding, right? And the only way to fix it was to SSH into the node and then restart kubelet. Such problems are so common in self-managed, and I'm just scratching the surface. And I'm sure people who actually provide Kubernetes as a service, they would be running this as self-managed themselves because this is their bread and butter. They would have countless amounts of such instances, which they would have already automated simply by the fact that they would not seen, simply by the fact that they would have seen this numerous times for all their tenants, right? And again, isolation in terms of compute layer when you're self-hosting it, like you have to, okay, that's a separate topic, but more outages. I mean, let's move on. I mean, I feel I'm very opinionated about not self-hosting, so let's move on from that. So another thing in managed control planes was just, maybe if the team is not upgrading as frequent as possible, not having automation or the automation itself having abstractions which are leaky. What do I mean by that? That, like, I've seen some automation sometimes where people, what they end up doing is, as part of, for example, there is a Helm migration happening for something and the version is going for 2 to 3. It's still an upgrade, but at the end of the day, what ends up happening is the automation has been written in such a way that there is a Helm, the operations are in such a way that one of the pods never get created. And there is a moment where it stays in pending because there's a dependency. Something is missed in the automation, right? So what I'm trying to say is that you might have such cases where the abstraction of automation is leaky itself. So paying attention to such leaky abstractions is something which I would highly suggest to sit down and fix. And as with everything, don't automate before you really know what you should be doing during the upgrade process, because it would be very tempting to just write something immediately, but that should not be the first response to seeing something which is repetitive. And cluster upgrades are really repetitive. There is no two ways to this. And you have to be patient, because if you do something which you don't really understand, as with everything, you will have consequences. And the consequences here would be that if you are in a phase where your organization is going from virtual machine workloads to container workloads, it would just create another distrust of why are we moving this to containers, right? Like, and such situations arise, right? And the obvious outcome is business loss. And that is something which an infrastructure team should take very seriously, because if there is no reliability provided by your team, I think people should really start questioning what is happening in the automation or the processes during the upgrade then, right? But that's pretty much, I mean, I think we could go on and on about this, but yeah. Are there any other questions? Otherwise, I'll just wrap up and give it over to Suraj.
Yeah. Well, the small talk turned out to be the lengthiest one, I guess. And yeah, interesting discussions there. So cool. Thanks, Tazik, for taking time and present to us. Also, thanks to very engaging audience asking questions and stuff like that. So I guess, yeah, this was our last talk before we officially end. There are a few things I'll ask speakers to give us links to their presentations, I guess, and then we'll treat them. And we also, if you folks are not on the Kubernetes Slack yet, I would highly recommend joining it, because you'll find all of us there. You'll find all the people who are working on these projects, developers, users, everyone. So it's the easiest way to get help, start contributing, whatever, I mean, the whole community, you know. If you folks have any feedback, please let us know. We are doing this alternate in-person online event. So yeah, we are open to feedback always. And if you think you have any topic that you would like to present on, please reach out to us on the Slack or Twitter or the meetup page, wherever. And yeah, I think officially that's the end. I'll stop recording, and if there are any other open discussions, we can do.